Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Greek Mythology Explained, a deeper look at classical Greek lore and myth, by Marios Christou and David Ramenah. Narrated by Derek Perkins. Introduction. Throughout history, storytelling has always played an important role in every culture. Once spread, a good story can capture countless imaginations and provide an endless amount of entertainment. But perhaps more importantly, it can also educate and instill moral values into an entire generation. Mythology is one of our oldest forms of storytelling, and even to this day it influences individuals all around the world. One of the great things about mythology is that it's ever-changing, because the primary way these tales were told was through word of mouth. As the stories travelled across cities, states, and countries, details were changed to alter their meanings. Acts of heroism may have been embellished to create excitement, and over time they became stories within stories, each having numerous interpretations. Often these stories resemble a summary of disjointed events rather than an in-depth, structured retelling. Characters can sometimes lack a real distinct personality in the original accounts of these tales, and we don't get a true sense of their motives and aspirations. In Greek Mythology Explained, we've remained true to the source material whilst filling gaps and exploring what really drives these characters and stories, creating a truly engaging experience. Between Scylla and Charybdis. 1. Together we are whole. Odysseus winced, one hand at the helm of the ship and the other clutched around his skull. He could still hear the song of the sirens they'd encountered a few nights prior, and like the ringing of tinnitus, it was there whenever the waves quietened. He still wasn't sure what was real and what wasn't, for those seductive she-devils had done a number on him, hovering at the edge of the ship and singing their bittersweet songs. He'd made sure the rest of the crew had stuffed beeswax in their ears so they couldn't hear it, but he'd willingly chosen to listen, because he was curious as to whether the tales were true. Indeed, they were true, and he'd have gone falling for any one of them if he hadn't had the crew tie him to the ship's mast, unable to move. He'd screamed for them to free him, but maybe it was just as well they hadn't heard him. Still, his head was on fire, and it hurt to even think for more than a moment. He sure had no intention of hearing their songs ever again, that was certain. He shook his head free of the thoughts. After all, he needed his wits about him now. "Can I interest you in a drink, sir?" Eurylochus stood beside him, calm as you'd like, slowly filling up a glass with red wine. If he had to tell his first mate no again, he'd probably shove him overboard. He didn't like to drink when on board. The last time he'd done that, he'd nearly rammed the ship against the shore and marooned the whole crew. But that didn't stop Eurylochus from trying. "No, thank you." He gently pushed the glass away, and Eurylochus looked at him with his flat, emotionless face and just shrugged, knocking it back himself. Odysseus supposed he couldn't blame him, given their situation now. This voyage was certainly shaping up to be an accursed one at best. The ship moved slowly, carefully inching forward as they let down the sail for a moment's breather. A streak of white light was strewn across the rippling blue waters, courtesy of the raging sun above, bringing with it a heat that had most of his men pacing about the deck shirtless and sweating. But Odysseus couldn't enjoy any of the grand weather, nor did he suspect his crew was, as they gathered before him in an orderly sort of cluster, about as orderly as they got, anyway. "It seems like we have two choices," Eurylochus was saying, as he slurped the wine and pointed over to the right, where a sheer chalk-white cliff towered over the ship. There was a scar-shaped crack in the cliff wall, and out from that crack spilled what Eurylochus had called Scylla. And by the gods, was it a beast! It had to have been at least twice the size of his ship, with six serpent-like heads that were moving as erratically as the waves, never still. From this distance, which wasn't necessarily far at all, it looked as if every head was hysterically laughing at them, bobbing left and right, as its razor-sharp teeth snapped open and closed. In amongst those six heads, however, was the haggard, misshapen head of a giant woman who looked dazed for the most part, eyes rolling back, languidly moving left and right. But that wasn't even the worst of it. Its body was a misshapen thing, all a sickly green colour with the sagging, wrinkling skin of an old woman. "We either sail past dear Scylla over there," Eurylochus said, "or we sail past Charybdis over there on the left." Charybdis wasn't much of a looker either, but at least it looked natural, conceived by nature herself. Odysseus hadn't considered it a monster at all, but Eurylochus had gone about naming it, and since then it had stuck. To Odysseus, it was a gigantic whirlpool in the near distance, sucking in the waves and anything else that was within its reach. Odysseus had to keep touching the helm, pulling the ship on course as it was gently tugged towards the water beast. Odysseus breathed in deep that salty, fresh air, and found himself coughing it all out. The crew's combined stench met him instead, an invisible cloud of unwashed flesh, sweat, dirty rags, and God knows what else. If they survived this, he'd have them all thrown in the sea with soap and wouldn't let them back on until they were a sight more dignified. You wouldn't catch him sweating and prancing about the ship, half naked and stinking. Even now, in the heat, he stood in his captain's uniform, with barely a drop of sweat on his brow. But he'd save the discipline of the men for the ones that survived. There was no use parting wisdom on dead men now, was there? He glanced at Scylla, and the six heads were still glued to him, their green eyes burning with an impatient rage. The old woman's head that sat atop the beast may as well have been asleep at this point. There was barely a twitch on her wrinkled, rotten face. Then he glanced over to Charybdis and saw the violent splashing of water as it whirled around and around, never stopping. It was like trying to choose a way to die. "Are you sure I can't interest you in that wine, sir?" Eurylochus gave him a nudge. Odysseus didn't even look at him this time, as he hearkened at the crew. "We have a dilemma." The crew stood to attention at his voice, and the ones who were cowering at the edge of the ship at the sight of the two monsters refocused their attention on him. "As you can see, we have to pass through these narrow waters with Scylla on our right and—" He stopped to look at Eurylochus. "Charybdis," he supplied. Odysseus rolled his eyes. "Charybdis." "Which one is worse?" someone called out from the deck below. "Scylla will no doubt tear our ship to pieces," Odysseus announced, before considering the giant whirlpool. "Charybdis will, well, it will also tear our ship to pieces." The crew made a resounding moan. "But if we go through Scylla first," Odysseus stroked his chin in thought, "we might be able to sail through, unlike Charybdis, who will suck us in, hold us in its grip, and never let go." He didn't say much else. He watched as the crew considered both avenues, perhaps the most thoughtful he'd seen them since they'd repelled the sirens. A few lines of hardened faces glanced up at him with grizzled respect, nodding to him as if they weren't fussed about which decision he'd make, because they'd stick by it either way. The others were a bit more hesitant, some of them chewing their nails and shaking in their sandals, their steel swords rattling against the wood of the deck. "Shall I have the men raise the sails?" Eurylochus asked, as he pointed at Scylla. "Hold on." He lifted his hand. They couldn't go about sailing in the path of Scylla with a good chunk of them soiling themselves. No, he'd have to do something to raise their spirits. He'd have to— "Maybe we should give them some wine," Eurylochus suggested. He must have sensed the same fear amongst the men. Wine wasn't going to do anything but make it worse in the long run.
"Men!"
he beckoned as loud as he could, grabbing every inch of their attention. He'd seen old captains give speeches to their men before, and somehow those strings of words were enough to give the men the feeling of iron skin whereby nothing could harm them.
"Men!"
he shouted again.
"We're tired, we're hungry, we're burning up, and we're all about done with this voyage, I imagine. But we're close to the end. In fact, the end is just beyond one of these two monsters before us. I know you're feeling low, you're feeling weak, you're feeling like our fate hovers above us. But if you can just give me one last push, one last fight, I promise you I will deliver us all home."
The men cheered, but it wasn't enough. Not just yet. Maybe because he didn't believe it himself. Maybe because he knew deep down that not even half of them were going to make it through this one. Certainly not all of them.
"I promise you," he added, "I promise you that despite our weak and subdued states, we will find our home. We're going to give it all we have here and now, as each and every one of us will emerge as legends of tomorrow."
That got them perked up a little more. Most of them had stopped their shivering, and the ones who were cowering in the decks below were finally spilling out onto the main deck, eyes glossy with hope.
"This is our life. The water and all who inhabit it will bow before us, and we will fight until the sun sets, because it's all any of us have ever known. Wouldn't you agree?"
"Yes!"
A resounding sound came from the deck, one so loud that even Odysseus was taken aback.
"Tired, hungry, broken? Is that what we are? Broken? Well, if we are broken, then together we are whole."
That got them roaring with energy, perhaps an energy he'd yet to see in them. They were slinging their hats in the air, some of them drawing their swords and hoisting them up, chanting his name as they did. Some of the bigger lads were hugging the edge of the ship, leaning out over it as they shouted insults and curses at Scylla, egging the creature on as it licked its several lips.
"We're all going to die, aren't we?"
Eurylochus muttered dryly beside him, filling up another chalice of wine. Odysseus looked at him and sighed.
"Probably."
2. Scylla's Fury. The boat crept up to Scylla, and the crew were as quiet as they'd ever been. None took their eyes from the serpent monster that awaited them with its animated heads moving in a frenzy as they hissed at one another, sharing their excitement at the approaching sailors. Odysseus took a glance over at the relatively impassive Charybdis and wondered if he'd made the right choice at all. Sure, he'd maintain control of the boat by facing Scylla, but Charybdis wouldn't try and take bites out of the hull now, would it? The crew were captivated. Odysseus had never seen them this entranced, not since that night a group of harlots had come on board. At least the harlots weren't half bad to look at. Scylla's saggy body was a gelatinous thing, spilling out of the crack of the cliff and drooling down its side. That old woman's enormous head seemed to get uglier as they approached, and she randomly looked up at the sun, smiling at it as if it had just told her she was pretty. The long necks of the beast were scaly and shining in the sunlight, but the hide looked thick and heavy enough to chop the ship in half like an axe through wood. Odysseus found that he couldn't take his eyes from the creature either as they drew nearer. So near now that they could all hear the cackling screeches each head sounded off with. It wasn't long before they were underneath it, the wood of the ship creaking as the waves seemed to silence around them. Scylla's heads slowly descended upon them, moving like slugs in a patch of grass, sniffing over the ship like it had never seen one before. The crew were scattered about the deck. Some of them had the decency to stick by the ropes, manning the sail, but some of them were in too much awe or fear to do much else but stare up at the beast, hypnotized by its very presence. It was the first time Odysseus had felt hot in his uniform, as he wiped a shaking hand across his sweating forehead. Was this what the men felt like? Two of Scylla's heads prowled around the head of the ship, another was lingering at the hull, and the remaining three seemed rather interested in the sail, brushing up against it as if it was soft to touch. Odysseus knew the only thing soft about this ship were the sheets in his quarters, but even those had seen better days. Their tongues protruded from their mouths as they scouted every inch of the vessel, moving about it as if it was theirs now. The ghastly face of the woman merely regarded them with a twitch of her misshapen nose, before her head lolled to one side. He felt his hand reach for his sword. Fat lot of good that would do in this moment. But it was better than standing around waiting for Scylla to turn violent, wasn't it? He wondered how much further they could sail before the creature turned on them, or whether they'd manage to sail out of its reach, as it became just as fascinated with the structure of the ship as his crew were with Scylla herself. He glanced gingerly to Eurylochus, and the man gave him a sideways glance back, the pair of them understanding that if they stayed perfectly still for just a few more moments, they'd be out of Scylla's reach. But then it happened. Scylla's heads exploded in one unified cry. Before anyone could move, one of the creature's heads nose-dived straight through the deck, blasting wood into the air as the men ducked for cover. Another head plunged against the main of the ship, knocking the entire vessel to one side with such force that Odysseus fell flat on his face. The whole boat turned. Water frothed up onto the main deck. A series of explosions came from all around as Scylla's heads battered the ship on all sides. Odysseus scrambled to his feet, only to see one of Scylla's heads sink its teeth against the mast. It pulled once, then twice, and then it ripped it out as easily as one might have plucked a bone from a chicken. It crunched it between its maw and winced when it didn't like the taste, before tossing it over its head and into the water. The crew were a mess, and while they tried to run for the deck below, Scylla was faster, picking men at random between its jaws and swallowing them whole. Odysseus caught movement in the corner of his eye, heart thumping like never before as a chill went down his spine. What was this feeling? Was it fear? Whatever it was crippling. So crippling, in fact, that it had him struggling with his sword. One head came barreling towards him from the left. Its big eyes were set on him. Its mouth opened wide. It screamed, and the gust from its mouth had him sucking in a breath of his own. It stank of something rancid. He struggled with his sword still. It was upon him, mouth enclosing around him. He was done. Eurylochus wrenched him back, and the pair of them went tumbling across the slippery floor, wrapped in a mess of limbs. Odysseus hit a panel of wood hard, and Eurylochus bounced next to him, unrolling with a large red stain down his chest.
"Are you hurt?"
Odysseus grabbed his first mate, fearing the worst.
"You're bleeding."
Eurylochus gave an expressionless look as he wiped his fingers against the red liquid and brought it to his lips.
"Made me spill my wine," he muttered.
"Now?"
Odysseus barked.
"You're drinking now?"
"What else is there to do with wine?" Eurylochus remarked, in a tone that implied he was least concerned about what was going on around him.
"Fool!"
Odysseus lunged for the helm. He had to get them out of this. Evidently sailing through Scylla was a poor choice, but it was clear now that Charybdis was the safer option. He tried to stand to spin the wheel, but each time he slipped with the way in which the boat was being pounded. Out on the main deck, he could hear the men screaming. He could hear Scylla snapping them up, carrying them into the sky before gobbling them up. Some men were shouting amongst themselves, trying to organize some form of defense. But in the end, their cries were the only thing Odysseus heard as their guts littered the deck. Odysseus spun the wheel from the ground, whipping it to the left until he felt the boat finally begin to respond. Ever so slowly it craned to the left, and while the mainsails were torn and flapping lifelessly, the boat still obeyed. If not slowly, perhaps so slowly that they wouldn't make it home, after all. Scylla's head still thundered down against the ship, randomly striking like a malicious child who'd found a camp of ants and was intent on killing them all. Odysseus tucked himself under the ship's helm, and Eurylochus did something similar, shuffling into one of the tipped-over barrels on the quarterdeck. Each time one of Scylla's heads pummeled the ship, the pair of them winced. It wasn't until the ship finally drifted away from Scylla that Odysseus crawled out from under the deck, scanning over the damage. It was not a pretty sight, to say the least. Corpses were strewn across the deck, pools of blood moving left and right as the ship was carried across the waves. Some of the men were still alive, at least, clutching at wounds and trying to resuscitate those who were down. One man hung from the nest atop the ship, his body tangled with the ropes and his head dangling by a thin bit of flesh. The smell of guts and soiled sailors filled the area, and Odysseus held his hand against his nose, unsure of what to say or do as they approached Charybdis. At least one of them wasn't lost for words, though, as Eurylochus strolled up with a chalice in hand, filling it infuriating slow. "Can I interest you in a drink, sir?" 3. Charybdis Inhales. They weren't sailing anymore. You couldn't call being dragged in by a sucking monster sailing. Odysseus peered over the edge of the boat and saw the way the water was surging towards the whirlpool. It wouldn't be long now before they were caught in the centre of the vortex, spun around helplessly, and then, well, only the gods knew what came next. "We're just going to sail right through it." Eurylochus was by his side, that same uninterested grey look on his face, almost as if he regarded the whirlpool with as much enthusiasm as he had regarded Scylla. "There isn't much else we can do, is there?" Odysseus said. He glanced back at Scylla, still sitting there between the crack in the cliff with its laughing heads, watching them head towards Charybdis. "Unless you want to go back and fight her." Eurylochus regarded Scylla for a moment, before shrugging his shoulders. "Maybe we should, if you even mention the wine, I'm going to slap you," Odysseus warned him, and that had the first mate clearing his throat and marching off down the main deck. There were only a dozen men left over. Perhaps not even that, what with the ones lying on the floor, some of them still and some of them twitching. Groans echoed out amongst the ship, and those who were standing were bleeding by the bucket load. One man was even missing an arm as he stared blankly into the ocean. "Maybe I should give another speech," Odysseus thought. But he was no speech giver. He'd stolen his last speech from his captain before him, but even that same captain would have probably given up on the sorry bunch down below. The ship had certainly seen better days. Large chunks of the hull had been bitten off by Scylla, and huge, jagged bits of wood stuck out in various places. One mast had collapsed against the main deck, squashing a man beneath it. The boom of the ship was crooked, and if Odysseus wasn't mistaken, it looked as if an amputated hand was clasped around it. The shrouds were tangled around the masts, one of them ripped and billowing in the breeze. You could hardly call this a ship anymore, just a drifting slab of wood with a crew that was either dead or dying. Charybdis was upon them faster than he'd liked. The boom of the ship hovered over the whirlpool first, then the beak of the ship descended into the water, quickly followed by the keel until the entire ship was brought forward, lulled in by Charybdis. Odysseus grabbed hold of the chains that had been slung onto the deck and wrapped them around himself, tied up his arms and held on for dear life. He could hear Eurylochus rummaging around for something, but he didn't dare look as he kept his eyes focused on the dark, spinning void at the centre of Charybdis. For just a moment, it seemed like they might have sailed through unburdened, but Charybdis was merely playing possum. They were wrenched to the side, and the entire boat was taken asunder for a moment. There was a collective scream, but the freezing water cut them off, shocking Odysseus and the men to the bone. Something about cold water made fear spread faster. Odysseus held on to the chains, but he was spinning through the water now, unsure which way was up. He opened his eyes, but the water made everything blurry as he was tossed around, spinning round and round as the chains unravelled about him. He saw the ship for a moment beneath him, but then it was gone, ripped away and stuffed somewhere, leaving him to be whipped around the water. He shut his eyes again. It was all he could do as he held his breath. Something slammed into him. It might have been another body for all he knew as he grabbed his own neck, clawing at it for air. He could feel the bubbles like needles going up his nose. He was beyond dizzy now, barely even awake as Charybdis took him round and round in a horrible, silent torture. There was a throbbing in his ears, but there was nothing else. There was no light anymore. Even as he opened his eyes, only the dark awaited him. For some reason, death by Scylla didn't seem too bad as Charybdis spun him faster and faster. 4. Washed up. Odysseus could hear the waves as he came to, coughing up his lungs as he rolled onto his side. Seagulls gathered high above, singing the same song they always sang as he spat out water. The light was too bright as he opened his eyes, so he had to hide beneath his forearm until his sight adjusted. He touched the ground, tentatively at first, until he realized that he was sitting atop a mound of rock, occasionally splashed by the spray of the waves. He spun onto his back with a shriek and went for his sword, only to find that it wasn't at his belt anymore. He had lost one of his boots and was left staring out into the ocean, alone. Well, not entirely alone. Scylla was still there in the distance, its heads dancing to a silent tune. Charybdis was nearer, still feasting on everything that came into its path and swirling it around and around. A wide array of flotsam bobbed along the waters that Charybdis failed to devour. Amongst the wreckage, Odysseus noticed one man hanging onto a large chunk of wood as he drifted towards him. Eurylochus wore the same uninspired face he had always worn, and merely looked inconvenienced by the outcome of such a devastating loss.
"That went well," he muttered,
as he flung the bit of wood away and climbed up the rocky mound. There really wasn't much room up here for the two of them, but Odysseus budged as much as he could.
"Are there any survivors?"
Odysseus asked.
"Probably not,"
Eurylochus shrugged. Odysseus sat there in silence, listening to the growl of Charybdis and the song of the gulls. Surely there hadn't been an attack like this on a ship before. Indeed, it was rotten luck to begin with, to be caught between both Scylla and Charybdis in the first place. But Odysseus felt as if he was owed a break by now, surely.
"You shouldn't blame yourself."
Eurylochus put a hand on his shoulder. Odysseus made a slow glance at it.
"I wasn't blaming myself."
"Oh," Eurylochus said,
"because it is kind of your fault."
"Yes, thank you, Eurylochus. Your support in this time is most appreciated," Odysseus snapped. The nerve of his first mate. Why, he would have shoved the man off the mound of rock if that didn't leave him entirely alone. Strange things happened to a man left alone at sea. Odysseus had heard tales of such things and had no intention of living them out himself.
"Won't be too long now, anyway,"
Eurylochus nodded at Charybdis. Odysseus frowned. Just what was this idiot on about now?
"The ship will come back up," he said,
when he found Odysseus' eyes on him.
"Charybdis always exhales what she inhales."
"What?" Odysseus shook his head in disbelief.
"What do you mean, she exhales?"
"Exhales," Eurylochus said, and gave him a demonstration by puffing out his mouth.
"Like a breath."
"A breath?" Odysseus narrowed his eyes at the man.
"Yes, the ship will be up again in a minute once she breathes it out. I thought a captain of your experience would know that much."
Eurylochus made a pompous sound.
"To Hades with it."
Odysseus started rolling up his sleeves. Even if it meant spending eternity alone, he wasn't about to hear another word out of Eurylochus. He went to grab the man by the throat, but then there came a rumbling sound deep from within the whirlpool.
"Told you,"
Eurylochus said, who either had no idea he was about to be throttled, or didn't give much of a care. Odysseus suspected it was the latter. A wooden block emerged from the whirlpool and hovered in the air for a few moments before crashing down onto the water. At first it was just an ambiguous wooden shape, but upon closer inspection, Odysseus realized it was indeed the ship, at least what was left of it. The sails were all but gone, just a thread or two flicked by the wind around the one remaining mast. The wooden banister around the outside of the deck was half chewed off, and it didn't look like the rest of the ship was in any better condition. There was now a gaping hole in the hull of the ship, from which water began to flood the lower decks. Still, it was nudged toward them by Charybdis like the wicked host it was, having its fun and then sending them on their way, worse off than when they entered.
"You may as well keep it,"
Odysseus shouted at the beast. How in the gods' names was he supposed to sail in that thing approaching them?
"It can't be as bad as it looks, can it?"
Eurylochus shrugged. Odysseus turned to look at him and almost ended up going to strangle him again. They managed to climb aboard once more, and for once, Eurylochus was right that it wasn't as bad as it looked. It was much worse. There were more holes in the ship than just the one in the hull. The ship had large wounds from where Scylla had drilled its heads through, and even now water was filling up in the cracks, rotting the wood and weighing it down. In fact, the only reason the ship was moving at all was because Charybdis was pushing them away. There was only one mast on the ship, and even that had a crack along its base, threatening to fall with the slightest push. Odysseus paced around the main deck and was about to make his way downstairs to the cabins to inspect the damage. But they had already been flooded, and the severed head of a crewmate bobbed gormlessly in the water.
"Confound it," Odysseus hissed. "The ship is full of holes. The sail has been ripped away. We have no food. The cabins are flooded, and all of our crew are dead."
"It is quite the predicament, sir," Eurylochus intoned. That was when Odysseus heard him filling a chalice with wine again.
"Where did you get that?"
he demanded. "Of all the things this fool could have found, he managed to find wine?"
"Of course he did."
"It was lying around." Eurylochus gave a limp shrug. "Can I interest you in a drink, sir?" He held out the chalice, full to the brim with red wine with the faintest hint of grape. Odysseus looked at it for the longest of moments, remembering that last time he'd taken a drink or two on deck, which resulted in him marooning the entire ship. He'd sworn he'd never drink again, did he not? He looked around at the ship and felt it gradually begin to sink as it moved further and further into deeper waters. With a huff, he shoved the chalice out of his face and reached for the bottle, snatching it from Eurylochus' hands and bringing it close to his mouth. He stopped to look at Eurylochus for a moment, waiting to hear some wisecrack or some comment about him going back on his word. But, damn him, he'd earned a drink, had he not? He chugged down the contents and didn't stop until it was empty. The wine would lift his spirit, albeit a slight. It hardly seemed worth rescuing the few men who submerged from the waters, but he and Eurylochus helped the stragglers back to the ship, or at least what was left of it. Still, he was alive, wasn't he? Why, he'd gone against the many heads of Scylla and made it through the abyss that was Charybdis, and he was still here. That had to mean something, did it not? Just like his encounter with the sirens, he was left fatigued, but a small part of him couldn't help but crave the next encounter. He licked his lips, still salty from the water, and paced his way over to the edge of the ship. He didn't know where the current would take their lifeless, crippled ship, and nor was he sure of what would happen as they drifted. The only thing he could be sure of was that his odyssey was far from over.
The story of Scylla and Charybdis explained. For fans of Greek mythology, it's likely you would have heard of Odysseus and his voyage. For those less familiar, Odysseus was a legendary Greek hero and king of the island known as Ithaca. The majority of knowledge we have regarding Greek mythology comes from ancient literature written by a handful of renowned Greek and Roman poets. One of these poets was Homer, who wrote both the Iliad and the Odyssey, which became key pieces of literature in relation to Greek mythology. In both of these poems, Odysseus assumes a key role, with the Iliad taking place during the Trojan War, and Homer's Odyssey focusing on the journey of Odysseus as he attempts to make his way home after the war. Our story takes place during Odysseus' encounter with Scylla and Charybdis at the tail end of his epic journey as he attempts to return home. They had just escaped the island of the Sirens, with Odysseus choosing to be tied to the mast in order to hear the sirens' call. The crew, with the use of beeswax as earplugs, were not affected by the sirens' call, while their captain begged and pleaded to be released into the sirens' clutches. The call itself is maddening, and Odysseus was the only man to ever hear it and live to tell the tale. It's likely it took its toll on Odysseus, leaving him far from his best when his next encounter took place. When travelling in between the island of Sicily and mainland Italy, Odysseus and his men found themselves needing to pass through a narrow strip of sea known as the Strait of Messina. To the left of their ship was a giant whirlpool, the monster known as Charybdis. To their right was the six-headed beast Scylla, who had been responsible for the death of hundreds, if not thousands, of sailors. Before realizing the situation, their ship was already being pulled in by Charybdis, making turning back impossible. Odysseus and his crew were faced with the dilemma of whether they should veer left into the path of Charybdis, where the ship would be sucked into the whirlpool, or steer right, where it's likely Scylla would smash their ship into pieces. Odysseus, knowing that turning into Charybdis would guarantee that the ship would be destroyed, chose to take his chances with Scylla and sailed close to her cliffs. Upon seeing the ship, Scylla emerged and began her vicious onslaught on Odysseus' ship. The ship itself would not have been armed with cannons and the weaponry we've come to expect from the pirating era, as this story took place thousands of years before. With that said, even if the ship had been armed, it's unlikely that any weapons of the time would have been enough to deal with a monster the size of Scylla. With the ship in pieces and dozens of his men dead, Odysseus had no choice but to steer his ship in the direction of Charybdis in the hope that what was left of the ship and his men would survive the encounter. As expected, the entirety of the ship was sucked into the whirlpool, and Odysseus was left stranded on a rock hanging onto an olive tree for dear life. The ancient Greeks believed that Charybdis was cursed with an unquenchable thirst and would have to drink from the ocean 3 times a day. During these times of day, Charybdis would inhale enormous amounts of water. But because of the curse placed upon her by Zeus, she would have to exhale and release all the water that she had swallowed. It was only when Charybdis eventually exhaled that Odysseus' ship was released. Odysseus climbed aboard and began searching for what men he could save, knowing that with a ship in pieces and with only a fraction of the crew alive, their journey home would be even more perilous than before. At first glance, this portion of Odysseus' story seems like little more than a hero's battle with two enormous monsters. Although that is correct to a certain extent, there is some deeper meaning that can be abstracted from the story. Scylla and Charybdis may be the title of the story, but it's also a Greek idiom that describes being in a situation where you have to choose between the lesser of two evils. It's quite similar to the modern phrase, between a rock and a hard place, which refers to a situation where you're faced with two equally undesirable outcomes. This underlying theme is definitely one that can be applied to us as individuals, even to this day. Most of us will come across situations similar to that of Odysseus. Now, of course, it's unlikely that we will be choosing whether to face an enormous six-headed monster or a whirlpool that destroys everything in its path, but we will have choices and outcomes we're not particularly fond of. Sometimes the choice or outcome we desire may not be plausible, and we can only do what we think is best, leaving us stuck to choose between the lesser of two evils. Lamia. 1. The Last Dance. Lamia held the small velvet box close to her heart as she all but skipped back to her palace. She wondered what lay inside ever since her beloved Zeus handed it to her, but she vowed not to sneak a peek until she returned home. It was more thrilling to wonder on what sort of marvel he had adorned on her, the anticipation of soon knowing making her stomach swoon. Perhaps it was some fine trinket, or some relic of old. For all she cared, it could have been a pauper's scrap, but she would cherish it forever nonetheless, merely because it was a gift from her Zeus. Dark clouds began to gather around the precipice of her gilded palace, but not even the sight of such a ghastly formation could dampen her spirits. Thunder rumbled through the sky at her approach, rolling across the air like the beating of drums. It reminded her of Zeus' laughter, and that put a dreamy smile on her face. Rain began to fall, the sound of it beating the ground, making what sounded like the hissing of 100 snakes. But still, her smile remained, and she caught a glimpse of it in a puddle as she strolled down the cobblestone streets, every inch of her serene and perfect. The wind nipped at her, and a chilly breeze made her surrender a shiver. The thought of Zeus kept her warm. Her palace stood before her, a charming and yet bold arrangement of spires and age-old stonework. Even against the greying sky, the palace maintained its regal stature, with flags flapping rapidly at the precipice of each dome. Tall windows were set on its face, and long silk ribbons sauntered down the front and sides of the palace, billowed gently by the wind. Her servants moved in like cavalry to greet their commander, falling to their knees before her. She gave them each a brilliant smile, for how could she not? She had been a kind and just queen, after all. Her subjects flocked to her, and a great few of them were blocked by the guards who swooped in not long after her servants had. They chanted her name, tossing roses and violets at her feet as she offered them all a regal wave of her hand. A thousand voices echoed their love for her, and a cacophony of whistling, hooting, and clapping never ceased to dazzle her ears. She set her sights on them all, and breathed in deep their every cheer and shout like they were feeding her, filling her up like sunlight to a plant. Young men blushed at the sight of her, waving kerchiefs or shoving one another out of the way to get the best sight of her. Some women stood with their hands clasped at their chest, admiring her beauty as she passed them by. An old man dropped to his knees upon her approach, but she laid a gentle hand on his shoulder and asked him to rise. Indeed, she was his queen, but she always respected her elders. The old man said nothing, but he grinned from ear to ear as she helped him back to his feet. A small girl came running into her arms. She was dainty and wore a yellow dress as bright as her giggle. Her mother appeared in the crowd, distressed, but Lamia smiled and the mother relaxed. She gave the girl a peck on her forehead and handed her back to her mother, who sounded off with apologies and 100 pardons. Lamia gave the woman's shoulder a reassuring squeeze and told her not to worry. Two boys, no older than 10 years of age, were trailing behind her, tossing flowers at her feet. She gave both of their heads a ruffle before scooping up a handful of the flowers and placing them in her hair. The boys looked at each other for a long moment, as if they had been touched by a goddess, before they broke out into red faces and laughed their way back into the throng. Still, her name was sung into the air, and despite the drizzle of rain, her people did not waver. A band assembled somewhere in the sea of citizens, and a fanfare broke out across the bevy, inciting clapping and dancing. She took the arm of a young lad and pulled him into a dance, and while he, a mere peasant, was unexpecting of such an honour, he did not disappoint. She spun around with him for a few rotations, twisting and frolicking to the tune of the band, before she was taken up by one of the boys from before. After that, she was dancing with a trio of merry women who could not stop proclaiming how beautiful she was. Lamia would tell them to look at their reflections more often if they wanted to see beauty. In a few hours, the whole town was dancing and the streets were filled with music, laughter, the clinking of glasses, and the songs they spun of her. She would have wanted it to last forever, but then all good things came to an end, did they not? As she pondered on that thought, her adviser grabbed her quite firmly by the wrist. "She's here," he muttered in her ear, distress painted on his face. Lamia gulped. "She is? In your chambers?" He nodded, like he'd just seen a ghost. "We can have the guards try and—" "Nonsense." Lamia placed both her hands on his quivering shoulders. "I will go." She clutched the box Zeus had given her, and looked upon her subjects once more, if only to capture this moment in her memory forever. Something in her gut told her that there wouldn't be a moment like this again. She made her way back to her chambers. 2. The Wrath of the Gods.
"Do you think you're beautiful?"
Hera bit off each word like any response other than "no" would be heresy.
"Zeus told me I was,"
Lamia would have said, if she had even a fraction of Hera's power. In fact, Zeus said it more than 12 times, mumbled it out of his wet lips each time she took his seed. But she knew better than to say anything of the sort to the raging goddess who now stood in her chambers, her eyes twitching with rage. All she could do was hang her head low, her knees drawn tight against each other in hopes that her docility would appease the furious goddess.
"You and my husband!"
she screamed loud enough that the paintings on the wall rattled. If the rest of the palace didn't know about her tryst with Zeus, they most certainly did now.
"Yes,"
Lamia spoke, her voice barely spilling out over her lips. She knew it was a mistake to engage Zeus, and while she heeded the warnings of her advisers, in the end, she could do nothing to resist him as he swallowed her up in his arms, lifting her high into Olympus and had his way with her.
"It will be just the once,"
she had told herself. A mere clandestine encounter beyond the ears and eyes of anyone except herself and Zeus, a secret they would share with only each other.
"It will be just the once,"
she had told herself.
"How many times?"
Hera demanded,
a vein in her forehead now throbbing like a contorted worm. Lamia took a deep breath.
More than a dozen.
Hera's eyes widened, her nose scrunching up as she bared her teeth at Lamia. The admittance of that truth looked like it physically pained Hera, as she wrapped one arm around her stomach, her expression like that of a caged animal pissed on by its captor.
Your betrayal has cut me deep.
Hera clenched her fists, and Lamia wondered how long it would take a goddess to beat the brains out of her.
Zeus betrayed you too,
she shot back, before she clamped her mouth shut, wishing she hadn't said a thing at all. Hera recoiled at that, her hand hovering gingerly about her heart for a moment, no longer a fist. It was as if she had only just now realized that her husband was just as much to blame as Lamia was. But then that fire returned to the goddess' eyes, her green inferno lighting up within the depths of her pupils. It was a fearsome sight as Hera's entire face began to contort. She was screaming in fury, spit spewing all over the floor. The blazing glow in her eyes was matched only by the pulsing of the veins down her arms. Lamia thought to run, but where could she go? Even as a queen, she could not hope to hide from Hera's vengeance. Lamia pressed up against the door, too afraid to try to open it, and so she took to shrinking up against it instead. The wind howled through the windows in tune with Hera's almighty roar. Lamia found herself pinned to her spot, unable to do anything as Hera leered at her. The goddess' breaths were like that of an angered dog, throaty and deep. Her shoulders were bunched up, every inch of her tense and ready to rip limb from limb. Lamia squeezed the gift Zeus had given her between her sweaty palms, if only for the modicum of relief it brought her.
Just do what you came to do.
Lamia tried to sound brave, but the desperation was evident through her cries. She wanted to live. Truth of the matter was, she wanted to see Zeus again. She wanted him to storm into her chambers now, fend off Hera and swoop her up in his arms the way he'd done so many times before. But Zeus didn't make a grand appearance. He probably wasn't even watching.
You think he'd come for you?
Hera hissed, like she'd read her mind.
He's probably with some other mortal harlot right now, insolent girl.
Lamia felt a sharp twinge in her heart at those words, perhaps because they were probably true. Zeus' appetite knew no bounds. If Hera couldn't sate him, what hope did she think to have? She wondered if he even meant the things he'd said, whether any of it meant more to him than just a night between the sheets. It had to have meant something, hadn't it? She looked down at the box and watched as a teardrop dampened a spot of the velvet lining.
This is what he does, Hera snapped. I thought you might be wiser to his ways, but I see now you are no different.
Hot tears were streaming down her face now. Zeus had to have loved her. He said it to her, had he not? The thought of him saying it to someone else just as easily made her chest tighten, and she suddenly found it harder to breathe.
Shed no tears.
Hera relaxed all of a sudden, the fire in her eyes dying as quickly as it came about. She folded her arms across her chest and took a slow, deep breath. She no longer looked at Lamia, but instead outside the window where the rain began to fall. We've all shed enough for him.
Aren't you going to kill me?
Lamia asked. Hera looked at her for the longest moment. Lamia knew in that hardened stare that she already made up her mind. She wasn't hesitating. She just enjoyed prolonging that suspense, enjoyed watching Lamia squirm for life. Lamia's fingers tightened around the box. A part of her wished to open it now, to know what her beloved had bestowed upon her before abandoning her to this fate. No, came Hera's voice, her eyes now set on the box as if she meant to pry it out of Lamia's hands. No, I'm not.
No?
Lamia didn't understand. She deserved to die for this, didn't she? Hera never stayed her hand in the past when confronting Zeus' concubines. It didn't make sense for her to do so now. Could it be she realized that Zeus was part of the problem at last?
Could it be she had finally taken enough from him that she could take no more? Lamia knew that if she was Hera, she wouldn't have been able to stomach this many affairs.
"You're not going to kill me," Lamia ventured, trying to hide the hope in her voice.
"I'm not going to kill you," Hera's voice came again, her wry smirk appearing on her lips.
"They are."
They materialized from the air itself, bringing with them a black smog. Two creatures, no bigger than a pair of foxes, began to take form right before Lamia's eyes. Both creatures hooted like wild baboons at the sight of food. They had pointed ears that twitched as they moved to stand on two hooved feet. Their arms were stubby and pilose, two unkempt dwarf-looking spawns with bulbous heads and misshapen features. Lamia squeezed Zeus' box close to her, but it was no box at all anymore. Instead, there was a glistening knife with a deadly razor edge. One of the creatures galloped after her and shrieked from its bloody lips. Before Lamia could get the knife up, the creature crashed into her chest, taking her to the floor. She felt its talons grab her throat the moment they landed. She gasped, placing her hand against the creature's grimy face, trying to push it off. But the creature just snapped her hand with its maw, its eyes fixed on her with a chilling grin. For just a moment, she thought she knew those eyes. But then she rammed the knife into its head and watched them fill with blood. The creature made a sad sort of croak before it crumbled to one side. Lamia didn't realize she was holding her breath. She let out a terrified gasp before wrenching the blade out of the creature's skull and backing up against the wall. Hera was laughing, perhaps now in a more manic fashion than before. Lamia didn't even know why she was fighting. Even if she could kill the last creature, Hera would finish her off with a mere flick of her fingers. The last creature went berserk at the sight of its fallen ally. It began screeching at her in a horribly alien sort of sound. It began galloping towards her, saliva spilling out of the side of its mouth like a waterfall. Its face was knotted into one ugly, maddened expression. Its jaw hung open, and several rows of teeth could be seen seated in the void of its mouth. Lamia managed to step out of its way, and it went crashing into the wall with a loud thump. Before it could regroup, Lamia made her move. She drove her knees into its spine, pinning it to the ground as she set her entire weight upon it. Then she lifted the knife up high and plunged it into its back. It let out a long, residing groan, but Lamia didn't stop. She ripped the knife out of its back and brought it back down again, grinding bone and flesh against the blade. Blood splattered in her face, some of it getting in her eyes. Still, she drove the blade into the creature, each stab weaker and weaker, until the weapon slipped from her grasp and went skittering across the floor. Hera's arms were around her stomach, hunched over in a fit of breathless laughter. She sucked in air, brought herself up to a standing position, and wiped a tear away. She couldn't seem to compose herself as she turned from mighty goddess to a giggling girl.
"What's so funny?"
Lamia screamed at her. Only then did Lamia realize that the creature beneath her had long, dark, silky hair, just like hers. The creature didn't have talons anymore, which confused Lamia. Instead, it had small human hands like those of a child. Lamia knew those hands. She let out a horrified shriek as she fell off the body and landed beside it. Just ahead of her, she saw the gaping hole she made in the head of the other creature, now just a blue-eyed boy in a puddle of blood. The knife began to change shape, and in the blink of an eye, it returned once more to the shape of Zeus' box. This time, Lamia didn't feel herself reaching for the box, because she was transfixed on the massacre before her. Her children were dead. 3. The Child Killer. A day would pass before they stripped Lamia naked and ushered her out of the palace doors and into the mob that awaited. What were once worshipping folk now became a current of vile faces, every one of them spitting and screaming at her as she stumbled through the street.
"Child killer! Zeus! Whore! Monster!"
She tried to hide her shame, but hands grabbed at her from all directions, yanking and shoving her off balance. She collapsed into the dirt more than a few times, her body now cut and bruised from head to toe.
She wasn't a queen any more. She was less than dirt in the eyes of her people. She was nothing.
Sinner!
She-devil!
Murderer!
She shoved her hands over her ears as she ran, but she couldn't block them out. She could never block them out. The same way she couldn't block out the images of her children lying there in their own blood. The mob threw things at her, mud and rotten fruit for the most part, but soon feces and gods knew what else. Her hair was damp with piss, and her lips were swollen from where she hit the ground and bashed her mouth. She was bruised from where her own guards groped, slapped and struck her like she was a common harlot and not their ruler.
Evil witch!
False queen! Child killer!
She could see the forest in the near distance, and knew they wouldn't follow her in there. She herself didn't wish to wander into the marshlands for fear of the harsh terrain and the wild beasts who roamed it. Then again, could those beasts be any worse than the ones that surrounded her now? Her feet were sore from blisters, and her ankles ached from where she had been kicked and tripped by a dozen different men and women.
Murderer!
Wicked queen! Child killer!
She tried to explain to them that it was Hera's doing, but they would not believe her. Even now she pleaded with them and begged them to heed her words, but they could no more understand her than a pack of wild dogs could. She was bleeding from the nose now, and the lashes on her back were stinging as if 1,000 wasps descended upon her. One man spat in her face, grabbed her by the hair and laughed as he yelled in her ear,
"Child killer! Child killer! Child killer!"
She managed to break away from him and limped her way off of the cobblestones and onto the grasslands. The mob must have realized her intentions because they began making hissing noises and hooting in the air at her. They soon stopped giving chase, and the last line of their entourage would spill away, albeit reluctantly.
Child killer! Child killer! Child killer!
Their chant would chase her into the woods, and while she promised herself she wouldn't look back, she did. Her palace was shrouded in shadow as the red sun began to retreat beyond the horizon. Her subjects were now nothing more than ambiguous shapes with pitchforks and lanterns barricading her from returning to her own home. They'd all betrayed her, and while she knew she couldn't blame them, she couldn't help but clench her fists as she heard their chant fill her ears once more.
Child killer! Child killer! Child killer!
In her hand was the box Zeus had given her. It was all she had left of him. In fact, it was all she had left of anything. She didn't open it. In fact, she didn't think she would ever open it, for it would forever remind her of what had happened. But to part with it was too great a thing. It was all she had now.
Child killer! Child killer! Child killer!
She turned her back on her people and descended into the depths of the woods, knowing full well that some day, somehow, she would have her vengeance upon them all. 4. What lies in the woods? The nights were the worst. The daylight didn't seep out of the forest as the sun retreated. No, the woods themselves were simply plunged into darkness in the blink of an eye. It wouldn't have been the first time she went sprawling onto the ground, bashing her knees against the hard dirt and, as luck would have it, hitting her head too. Panic set in as she lifted her head. Her heart rate quickened, and she had to slam her hand over her mouth to halt her anxious breaths. The monsters out here had acute hearing, after all. With the daylight gone, she was left blind. Nothing terrified her more. But at least the darkness brought some relief. She could see nothing, and therefore she could see nothing that would remind her of her past. Sometimes she even shut her own eyes, as if it would somehow make the dark all the more prominent. She scrambled on her hands and knees, careful not to make too many loud noises for fear of the creatures descending upon her. She'd done well to avoid them thus far, but deep down she knew it would not stay that way. Her stomach rumbled as she curled into a ball at the base of what she hoped was a tree. If it was anything else, it could go right ahead and consume her and put an end to her miserable life. It didn't change the fact that she was hungry, though, and her stomach wasn't in the mood for playing the quiet game. The wind whipped at her and rustled the leaves of the trees, making them hiss all around her. She would have been colder if she was still naked, but thankfully she found an old sheet marooned on a high branch and climbed to claim it. She wrapped it around her like a dress, but her arms were still exposed and suffered from cuts, bruises, and a severe case of goose pimples. Her nose was running, but she had to keep using her hand to wipe it, despite desperately wanting to blow it. If she made such a sound in the thick of the night, the monsters would surely come for her, wouldn't they? She heard one of them circling her just the night before. It might have been a wolf, what with its snarling and growling, but for just a second she caught glimpse of its yellow eyes glowing in the shadows. Whatever it was fled in the other direction, and though she was sure it gave chase, she would stumble down a steep hill and manage to escape its clutches. Such luck wouldn't shine on her forever, though. She didn't want to hug onto Zeus' box, but hugging that seemed better than hugging herself. She laid her head against the dirt and surrendered tears and sobs for the sixth or seventh night in a row. By the gods, how many nights had it been? She pined for her kingdom, pined for her people, pined for her children, and, ridiculously enough, found herself pining for Zeus. She stared up at the night sky, an endless black sheet with the faintest smudge of stars staring back. Why would Zeus allow her to suffer like this? He told her he loved her, didn't he? He looked her in the eyes with a face as serene and pure as anything she'd ever known. He wouldn't have forsaken her like this, would he? This is what he does. Hera's words sunk into her like the fangs of a viper. No, maybe Zeus had indeed forsaken her. That thought made the tears flow even more. She clutched at the box for dear life, hoping that he would come charging down from the stars, but just like the previous nights, he didn't show. She felt stupid for thinking that he would. There was a snap of a branch and Lamia nearly shrieked. She couldn't see anyone at first, only the endless void that the woods had become. But then there was an ambiguous shape swaying just ahead of her, hardly trying to be discreet like she was. Its eyes came into focus. Two green eyes that glowed like Hera's. The light from its eyes gave birth to the misshapen form of its face, but any details or expressions that the creature possessed, Lamia couldn't see. It skulked ahead of her, and its feet must have been wet, for they squelched in the mud. Whatever it was breathed like something was stuck in its throat, a low throaty wheeze escaping its lips. It swung its arms about in a languid fashion, but if she wasn't mistaken, they sounded like the beating of heavy wings. Its head snapped left and right as if it was looking for something. Lamia got a sinking feeling that it sought after her. It
moved like a. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.